Hello, everybody, and welcome to my talk on C++ modules. There was a complimentary talk given by Cameron and Gabby on Monday. It contains, amongst others, an explanation for what the result that I will present near the end of the talk. I'm Daniela, an electrical engineer living in Germany. I'm creating software since my teen years, when microprocessors became popular in the late 70s. 2 points before I start. Firstly, I have a lot of material to cover. Please hold your questions to the end of the presentation or the Q&A. Each slide is numbered to give you a reference when asking questions. And secondly, this is not a beginner's talk on modules. I gave one 2 years ago. If you never heard anything about modules before, this is probably not the right talk for you. So in the first part, I will speak about the foundations of modules. I will give a very brief overview of what modules are about and how they look like. Which tools do we have to compose modules? And then I will move on to the key features that shape the functionality of modules. The visibility of names versus the notion of reachability, and linkage, or when does the same name refer to the same thing. The second part is about modules in practice. How can you proceed into the modules world? What do you need to know when importing modules? What are practical benefits of using modules? And what is the current state of the modules ecosystem? Modules are one of the major additions to C++ 20. They are probably the most transformative feature in the sense how we think about designing interfaces between portions of our software and how they will help us to avoid hard to detect problems. Let's face it. Today, we are doing it wrong. We follow the book of John Lakos' book, of course, layer our software, create libraries and such, and probably all this did. We protect the library implementation from being invaded from the outside and then throw its interface over the wall, stripping it of any protection into a shark tank full of other pieces of software that don't care a single bit about our poor interface, or maybe outright hostile to others without even knowing. So familiarity doesn't imply greatness. For technical reasons, the interface header might need to contain implementation details of the library that are required to form the interface, but are actually not meant to be used outside of the library, like template definitions or inline functions. In some cases, all of the library implementation is included in the interface. The interface header is then textually inserted into translation units of the library implementation sources and also into the client translation units that consume the library. In the C++ compilation model, boundaries exist only between translation units. Foreign code is barred only from intruding the translation units of the library implementation. The interface headers just do not benefit from this level of protection. The compilation of a translation unit starts out from a given compiler state as set up from the compiler environment, like compiler flags, macro definitions, and also an empty set of declarations. At the point that the library interface header is started being processed by the compiler, the compiler state may have changed by all of the stuff the compiler has already processed so far. The compiler state at that point may be different in different translation units, giving rise to different interpretations and meanings of literally identical C++ text in the interface header. This may lead to subtle bugs because of ODR violations. Definitions might no longer be the same in all parts of our program. Yet again, we are doing it wrong. At the end of the compilation process, an object file is generated, and all of the compiler state with all of the collected information is discarded. Using the library in different translation units requires compiling the same headers over and over again. Not exactly efficient. Quite some time ago, near the turn of the millennium, it became apparent that we need to do better, and now we can. Modules change the compilation model such that the interface of a library is no longer textually inserted into translation units, but rather becomes a translation unit on its own. This shifts the protection boundary to the place between the library and the client code, right to where it belongs to be. Well, just a minor drawback. This protection comes with a price tag. We need a new communications channel that makes the contents of the interface available to both the implementation of the library itself and also to the clients of the library. This channel is a compiled form of the interface translation unit with an equivalent representation of its contents. The compile environment is no longer a concern. The semantical meaning of the interface is immutable. It's compiled only once, so there's no place left for ODR. We users are happy, but compiler implementers are in big trouble. It's a major task to implement this. The additional artifact is called Built or Binary Module Interface, in short, BMI. Everything in the BMI is available within the library, but only selected parts become available to the outside. The architect of the library interface decides on which entities she wants to make available rather than being forced by technicalities of the language. The compilation of the interface starts from a known compiler state that is untampered by unrelated C++ text. Besides the object file, the compiler will also emit the BMI with the representation of the language entities that it collected during the compilation. Implementations may also put some info about the initial compilation state into the BMI to prevent ABI problems. Compilers should better make you aware of combining libraries with incompatible ABIs. With BMIs, compilers can do it now. So not only compilers can do better, tools can take advantage of this also. I think this is the way. So how does a module look like? In the new world of modules, there are not only modules, but all the code that still exists outside of a module as well. For the sake of consistency, this part of the world is said to be the global module that has no name, and the code in there follows all the traditional rules about your language. Beginning with the declaration of a module and its name, we enter the module purview. The module name must be unique to each module within a program. Every entity that's declared in the purview becomes part of a new domain of names that is separate from all names in the global module and also from all other modules. Be aware that this new name domain is not a namespace. Names introduced within the purview can be referred to from inside of the module, but not from the outside. When the module declaration has the export specifier at the beginning, it is the module interface translation unit. Each module has exactly one. By prepending a declaration with an export keyword, the declaration is made available to the outside of the module. Other translation units that import this module can then refer to exported names. Without an export keyword in the module declaration, the translation unit is a module implementation unit, of which there may be as many as we library developers want to. Optionally, a module translation unit may start with a piece of code that is not part of the module purview, but rather the old style global module. You can put your existing code or other code living in the global module here into the so-called global module fragment. This code can then be used as usual from within the module purview. Modules may also import other modules, either as non-exported implementation details, or they may even become an integral part of the module interface by re-exporting their interface. You cannot see the provenance of the entities that a module exports. The composition of a module interface is totally hidden. There's actually a zoo of module translation unit types besides the primary module interface and the module implementation units. Each of them has a unique set of properties. You can pick the appropriate types to compose a module. Header module units are special. They have no name, no architected interface, and even maintained other translation units by leaking preprocessor macros into them. So let's look how to compose modules out of them. This is the oldest, most canonical form of modules, a module interface with a bunch of module implementation units. That's often a purely mechanical transformation from old to new. Turn the interface header into the primary module interface unit. Turn the implementation sources into module implementation units by adding module declarations and export specifiers. In larger libraries, you may want to split both the interfaces and the implementations into module partition units. The interface partitions are then consolidated in and are exported through the primary module interface. Implementation details may be put into module partitions of their own, thereby replacing library internal headers. If your compiler doesn't implement module partitions yet, or you may just prefer to, instead of splitting a module into partitions, it can alternatively be split into a hierarchy of independent but related modules. The interfaces of these related modules are then re-exported through the primary module interface unit of the top-level module, like with the partitions in the example before. The opposite is also possible. Put everything into the primary module interface unit, for example, like with header-only libraries or so. This may increase the size of the BMI though. If the definitions from the formerly implementation sources shall be inaccessible as before, put them into a private module fragment. This is basically a module implementation unit directly incorporated into the primary module interface unit. The contents of the private module fragment don't become part of the BMI, but only the compiled object file. So, how do modules achieve their stated goals? The first part of the answer is related to names and to visibility. Visibility is probably that property that programmers are most familiar with. The C++ standard says that a name is visible when it's not hidden. But that's only partially helpful. Basically, a name is visible when it can be found during name lookup. When you refer to a name and the compiler goes out to find an entity with that name. But before that, a name needs to be introduced by a declaration in the first place. Within the translation units, B because compiler never look into other translation units. So divisibility of a named entity depends upon if it is declared within the translation unit before it's being related, being referred to, and the programmer uses an appropriate lookup algorithm. That lookup algorithm must be capable of finding a name in the scope of its declaration from the scope where the name is being looked up from. Otherwise, a name is invisible at the point of lookup. It may still be visible from a different point of lookup. If we perform name lookup for entities at class scope, a lookup is less restricted to the case in the case of templates, where the scope is that of a dependent class type, and lookup during the definition of a class. In these cases, names can be referred to even before they are defined. The lookup of these yet unintroduced names is deferred until after they are actually introduced. Sometimes it takes more than regular unqualified name lookup. For example, when referring to names introduced in sibling namespace scopes, or entities in outer namespaces shadowed by entities of same names in nearer inner namespaces. This lookup requires a search algorithm called qualified name lookup. Or when referring to names of a friend function in class scopes, so-called hidden friends, that inhabit the twilight zone between class scopes and their surrounding namespace scopes. Referring to hidden friends requires the algorithm called argument-dependent lookup, or in short, ADL. With types defined in a function body that are returned by return type deduction, the returned object can be used as usual, even though the name of the return type is totally invisible outside of the function. The compiler still has full knowledge of the type of invisible name, though, because it can read into its definition. It has compiled the definition in the function body and retained this information. An entity being invisible does not imply it to be unknown. So far, translation units erect barriers between them that make names declared in a different translation unit totally invisible. Modules extend visibility across translation unit boundaries by passing names declared in the module interface translation unit through the BMI into other translation units that import this BMI. Remember, visibility is only about names of entities to make them available for name lookup. If a module translation unit imports a BMI that's compiled from another translation unit of the same module, which is the module interface or a module partition, all names declared in that other translation unit becomes visible. By importing the BMI, these names are introduced into translation units as if they were introduced by compiling the declarations themselves. Marking an entity in the primary module interface translation unit or a module interface partition as exported, the names of only those exported entities can be introduced into other translation units outside of the module. All other non-exported names in the BMI remain invisible. So exported names become visible everywhere. Non-exported become visible only within the module itself. It's you, the library developer, who decides which names in the interface translation unit become visible and which names remain totally hidden outside of the module. So far, we've hardly made a distinction between the visibility of a named entity and the knowledge of other properties of that entity. Only in the example with the seemingly anonymous function return type whose name is unknown outside of the function, we've encountered a disconnect of visibility from the ability of the compiler to reach into the definition. This notion of reachability of declarations and their properties is separate from and orthogonal to the notion of visibility. This distinction hardly ever bothered us. In the traditional C++ world, the compiler knows everything about every declaration in the translation unit as soon as it has compiled it. But now, reachability becomes important in the modules world. BMIs compiled from module interfaces do not only act as a tunnel to transport names that make them visible in other translation units. Their second duty is to make declarations in the module become reachable when necessary. In this example, the module mod imports another module stuff as an implementation detail to use an exported class as member variable in class S shown here. This class is not exported from module mod, but returned from the exported function foo. Class S has a member function what that returns the result of calling member function message on its member variable without ever mentioning the name of that return type. So far, importing another module forms a so-called interface dependency on that other module. Its BMI must be available for compilation, or it is called to be necessarily reachable. But there are more dependencies. The non-exported class S uses a non-exported type from another module as member variable. Struct S has a member function that uses this member variable in its definition. Function return types that are either explicitly named or implicitly inferred without mentioning their names. At least some knowledge about these entities must be available at compile time to give meaning to the code. When the translation unit at the bottom imports the interface of module mod, only the name of the exported function foo is visible. Nevertheless, the compiler knows enough about the properties of the object that's returned from foo. It has a member function what, and the result type of that member function has certain properties that can be checked for at compile time and be used at runtime. These so-called semantic properties are made available, called reachable, by virtue of the BMI. So, what are the semantic properties of declarations or definitions? Some are defaulted, like C++ language linkage. Some are mandatory, like function signatures. And some are optional. It depends on the context. If we want to export function name n colon colon bar, all its semantic properties and those related must be made reachable in the importing T translation unit. So let's summarize. Reachability is the ability of the compiler to query all known properties of a given object. Visibility is the ability of the compiler to unambiguously find out which entity is linked to a given name. In the compilation module of C++, each translation unit is compiled separately and independently from all others. The linker will then put all these pieces together into the final program. The ability to do so meaningfully is called linkage. It describes properties of the ABI like calling conventions, and it prescribes consistently applied rules of forming linker symbols from these entity names, such that entities of the same name in different translation units result in the same linker symbols and compatible calling ceremonies. The formation of linker symbols is augmented in the worlds of modules to allow for the additional semantics of names declared within the module purviews. In this example, we see two different modules declaring two different non-exported, non-translation unit local functions foo that are invoked from the bodies of exported function definitions bar and bus in namespace A. The language rules demand that importing modules into the same client translation unit causes no problems whatsoever, even though both modules declare functions of identical names in the same namespace. As members of the respective module purviews, these functions are set to be attached to the modules. Namespaces extend across translation unit boundaries and they are therefore not attached to modules, but rather attached to the global module. In a sense, names attached to a module seem to carry kind of a scent or branding that isn't noticeable at the language level. This scent is necessary to make them distinguishable than forming the program. Names attached to the global module without name don't have this scent. To do so, we say that non-exported entities have module linkage rather than external linkage. Besides that, module linkage and external linkage are the same. Exported entities still retain external linkage despite being attached to the module. When the compiler forms linker symbols from entities attached to a module, with either module linkage or external linkage, the scent that marks these entities as belonging to the module becomes apparent in the mangled linker symbol. Here we see the name mangling by different compilers. Symbols formed from names with module linkage must be different from symbols of entities with identical names in other modules or the global module. Symbols formed from exported names may be distinguishable, but don't have to be. We call this difference in linker symbol formation to be following two schools of thought in regards to module ownership. The so-called strong ownership model, which retains the provenance of a symbol, and the weak ownership model, where the provenance is removed. Neither is better or worse by itself. It depends on the use case. If we look at the slides, we can see the benefit of strong ownership model that identical names can be exported from different modules and used in separate translation units. And the benefit of exported names can be moved freely between modules and headers. In certain situations, the loss of provenance may cause unpleasant surprises, though. Here, an unfortunate customer buys libraries from two different OEMs. Both libraries are delivered as binary static libs with interface headers. This is typical in some industries like mine. Both of them happen to use the same library from a third party, but in different but compatible versions. The use of that third party library is an implementation detail that is in no way exposed to us clients at all and totally undetectable at the language level. This third party library happens to be made available to both OEMs through a module with different module names dependent on the library version. All libraries work perfectly, but a poor customer, possibly me, that buys these OEM libs and uses both of them in the same product might either end up as a happy camper or face the insurmountable problem of not being able to link the program, depending on the compilation platform. And the origin of the problem lies in the third-party module that the customer isn't even aware of, and that both OEMs refuse to accept as a defect of the library. In case you are concerned about the divergence of behavior on different platforms, never mind. We've got ways to make this fail also on platforms that follow the strong ownership model. By explicitly giving a name either C or C++ language linkage, the name is reattached to the global module and supposedly mangles accordingly, at least MSVC does. If you need to simulate the weak ownership model with a compiler that follows the strong ownership model, you can explicitly give exported names C++ language linkage to detach them from the module. In the second half of this presentation, I will dive into practical aspects of modules. You have two options to create modules. A named module is the preferred option, though. Do everything you can do to make this happen. Resort to header units only if there is no better choice. But be aware, you are unwittingly and quickly entering implementation-defined land. By the C++, C++20 standard, only the standard C++ library headers must be importable. Everything beyond that is at the discretion of the compiler, even though compilers are not so picky about the contents of headers in this regard. This strategy of creating a so-called dual mode library is the most difficult one, but may help in the transition path. As a longtime contributor to the widely popular formatting library, I'm familiar with it and know a thing or two about its inner design. I had to find proper answers to two questions. Is this possible at all, given the requirements? There are lots of macros that are there to support as many platforms, compilers, and language standards as possible. The unrestricted usability as traditional library must be maintained. And in case of a named module, implementation details, must be hidden. The answer, not without giving up or address at least one of the requirements. Header modules can't hide the implementation details. And named modules can't export macros. So what to do? The answer is C++20 to the rescue. Forget about exporting macros and use modern language alternatives like UDLs. And the formatting library has this already implemented to make this available. The second question, which strategy to follow to turn the existing code into a dual mode library? There are some issues with the existing code structure. Changes may be a hard sell. The maintainer might refuse them. So the answer to the question is keep the structure as is and separate the exported API from the not exported implementation details using some preprocessor tricks and wrap the existing formatting files by a single file module. So one need to add a new translation unit to the library, the primary module interface unit, because I already said every module must have exactly one of those. Take advantage of the most powerful workhouse in our stable, a single file module with a private module fragment. The trinity of all sections that can comprise a module interface, namely the global module fragment, the module purview, and the private module fragment, serve different important purposes. This is basically a unity build of the whole library with two artifacts, the compiled interface called BMI, and the compiled implementation that is put into the object. Doing so, you benefit from the advantages of a named module, but can keep much of the existing code just as is. You get the same properties as a named library, like total isolation and a cleaner interface free of implementation details being visible. It enables the gradual transitioning into modules world, depending on the maturity of the compilers that you use. And it doesn't require changes to existing tests. It also doesn't require re-architecting the inner dependencies. In the beginning, there were some issues with the API because of in the traditional libraries, the visibility of names is the same when compiling, for example, templates in the library headers and instantiating them in the client code. But now, in the modules world, we have the separation of visibility as shown before. Compiling the interface translation unit provides unrestricted visibility, and compiling the import client translation unit by importing the module, you get the restricted visibility. And don't forget, this applies both to named modules and header units. So what are the potential pitfalls? Instantiating the exported function template foo is fine here because the call to template, to function template bar, is fully qualified in both name lookup, and overload resolution is fully done during the compilation of the module interface. The call to function bus is type dependent, and name lookup and binding must be deferred to the instantiation of function template bar caused by instantiation of the exported function template foo in client code that imports the module. So name lookup to bus will fail. Solution one to this problem, shown in the top, get rid of all the dependencies when performing name lookup of name bus. Or solution two, keep type dependency, but bring non-exported names into the function body, which means make them a part of the semantic properties of bar for consideration during the lookup of name bus. Please beware of entities with internal linkage at namespace scope than importing headers as header units. This is quite common than defining constants. The lookup of name, the answer is will fail than importing the header sum.h. The solution to this is give the affected entities external linkage so that these names are then made available through the BMI of the header unit. Or solution two, wrap them into entities with external linkages like an enum or a struct. So then they are just semantic properties of the respective entities. And these are made reachable through the interface. Another point, the inline specifier inline or implicit inlining of in-class function definitions is no longer a vehicle to prevent ODR violations. Module interfaces are composed only once anyway. If explicit inlining hints if you don't violate the rules of exposing translation unit and translation unit local entities. Calling translation unit local functions from other translation unit local functions is safe. Calling them from, for example, inline non-translation unit local functions is not independent from being exported or not. Compilers diagnose exposure of translation unit entities. If you want to learn more about this exposure kind of thing, please refer to the link given in the slide. You will look up the link also in the PDF slide deck of the presentation here. Within the formatting library available as dual mode library, it can serve as a perfect test ground to check for possible compile time reductions because of module imports rather than header file includes. When used as traditional library, it offers two configurations, a static or dynamic library with pre-compiled implementation sources, or a header-only library with implicit compilation of the implementation sources. In many cases, only the required parts of the API are made available through selective includes from the set of header files. So let's examine multiple ways of providing the API to translate to client translation units of the formatting library, which is provide the required API through including the headers. In the second scenario, including the headers, but take advantage of automatic include translation into imports if available in a compiler implementation. A vendor-provided modularized standard library helps reduce the BMI sizes in this case. The third scenario, import the format headers if deemed importable by the compiler. That's not portable though. And lastly, import a named module format. The fictitious call to the AP function shown in the example requires as bare minimum 3 or 4 header files. Some of them are implicit. Let's take the baseline, the overhead of compiling an empty main. And this baseline is on my function, my machine setup here, as shown in the bottom of the slide, 31 milliseconds. We don't actually compile the library call, but rather just provide the required API through including the necessary headers directly and indirectly. So on my machine, the header only configuration takes about a second, and the static library configuration takes about half a second. With the same test code as before, but now we use a modularized standard library and take advantage of one particularly interesting feature of C++20, automatic include translation. You can see the link to the specification of the language in the top of the slide. The compiler no longer actually includes certain header files, but rather treats them as header units and pre-compiles them in advance to then export the respective BMIs. If implemented, this mechanism is guaranteed by the standard to work for the C++ standard library headers only. But implementations may expand this special treatment to all header files they deem importable and also eligible to include translation. By doing so, our compilation times are already halved in respect to doing the includes without include translation. In the third scenario, every header from the formatting library is compiled as a header unit, cached, and then imported into the client translation units when needed. This involves no more than reading the contents of the referenced BMIs into the compiler internal tables. No compilation needs to be performed to provide the API. As we can see, on my machine setup, the compilation times are just minute. So we see imports are really fast. So far, the improvements in compilation times were impressive with every step into the modules world. But before comparing the figures that have been shown before with the compilation times and using the formatting library as named module, I want to ensure a fair comparison with a level playing field. So redo all measurements, but this time providing the full API instead of just a partial API as before. All times taken increase considerably because of the additional formatting library headers and additional STL headers too, that need to be included or imported. The number of code lines raised to about 90,000, and the BMI sizes grow a lot too. But now the final, most important figures, FMT as a named module. There is only one configuration that contains everything, more than all the configurations we've seen before. This requires the largest number of code lines to be grokked by the compiler. Even though there are nearly 130,000 code lines involved, the resulting BMI is the smallest because, in total, there are much fewer entities made visible. And this makes the import of named modules so incredibly fast. There are four orders of magnitude in compilation time to provide the API. And there is one order of magnitude in the size of the BMI. If you want to learn more about why this is the case, please revisit the talk given by Cameron and Gabby Monday evening, and you will learn a lot of interesting things, how this actually works. So what about the implementation status? MSVC's implementation is the most complete, most polished, best documented, and most usable one. This is the reason why I did all of my examples using MSVC. GCC and Clang are lacking a lot with errors in the implementation of the proclaimed features. They are only partially usable so far. So if you want to start using modules, probably go with MSVC first instead of handling troubles with the implementation errors of the other compilers. And the same is with build systems. I could find only four build systems with at least some support for modules. Build 2 by Boris, Evoke by Peter, MS Build by Microsoft, and you can also use your familiar make-like tools, but you need to implement your own rules to support compilation and consumption of modules. Here are some additional resources you might want to look up, and also my contact details. And with that, are there any questions? I'm ready to take them. So here's a question from Vincent Doremy. Could modules improve ABI compatibility? I don't think so. Modules don't affect the ABI at all. They only affect the name mangling depending on strong the ownership model or weak ownership model. The next question comes from Nicolas Morales about module composition. What is the difference between a hierarchy of primary module interfaces and module partitions? Why would one prefer over the other one? It's just a matter of taste, I did say. You can use both of them. It depends on the compiler implementation. If module partitions are supported, in this case, it's just a matter of taste. And if your compiler doesn't provide module partitions yet, you have to use the hierarchy. There's a question from Tomasz Kaminski. Could you explain why using detail bar is required for exported template example? The question revolves around name visibility. If you I need to look at this slide to exactly see what it, can we defer this question to the Q&A session after? I will address it in the Q&A on GetterTown. There is a question from Nicholas. Any idea when CMake will support modules? I have no idea. They are working on that. And so you probably ask Kitware about when CMake will support it. I've been using CMake for the CI tests of the formatting libraries, but the current versions of modules have problems with the Visual Studio code generator. So at present, the CI pipeline of testing modules doesn't work. But I think this will be addressed soon. Another question from an anonymous participant. In other words, modules' purpose is to design better interfaces and also just use what you need in your program. This is right. This is the most notable benefit from using modules. You design your interface rather than being forced by the C++ language technicalities. You make exactly only those names visible to the outside of the module that you want to. Everything else is not visible outside. And this is the best thing you can have. And this relates to the next question seen here. Can you explain a bit more why using header units is so discouraged? It sounds like it would be the most common path for libraries to support both non-modules and modules. Yeah, the point is, if you use header units, you no longer have an architected interface. It's just the same interface as the header provides when you use it as an include. So everything that needs to be in the include, because for the technicalities of the language, are made available through header units. And this is just a bad thing. We want architected interfaces rather than interfaces that are just an artifact that is imposed on us. The common path for libraries to support both non-modules and modules. Yeah, you can do it to do that, but it doesn't help to actually clean up your interfaces. So this is the reason why, in particular, the implementers of modules with strong ownership model do not like the header units. Another reason is header units become very quick, quite easily, like very big, quite easily, because you do not only export your own interface, but also expose everything that your header includes, like other headers or the standard library headers. So this is not a good choice.